I'm back with four brand new shapes of our Joggle's Wonky Wood Houses. With different roof lines and the addition of eaves on some, this new group is all kinds of creative fun just waiting to happen. We'll cover some with scrapbook paper, get our fingers all painty with others, and then embellish with ideology components. In the first Wonky Wood Houses video, the first step for each of the houses was to apply a layer of gesso, and I'm going to show you that quickly, but then I'm going to also just as quickly contradict myself, because the first house that I show you actually is not going to do that, but I want to get some gesso on here and I want to let it dry. So I like to work from these jars just because it's easy to dip your palette knife in there. Now I'm not going to show you the whole thing, but you're going to put gesso on all sides of this. I'm just going to quickly show you on this front for now. And all I'm going to do is scrape a very uneven layer of gesso on here. I'm not looking for uniformity. I'm not looking for anything other than some coverage. Though poplar is a very white wood, occasionally you'll get some areas that are darker, but even if it's all fairly light, that color will alter whatever you put on top of it. So gesso is a way to change that and get some truer color. So again, I'm going to just do it like this for now, but you're going to go ahead and do the entire thing a little bit at a time, allowing all the sides to dry. So let me get this out of the way, and let me bring in the house that we're actually going to work on with the gesso off my hands. So this is the first house. Let's stand this up so you can see it. This is the first house we're going to do. Now, the difference between this and what I just did is that this house doesn't require any gesso. Because I've put scrapbook paper on the front of this, there's no need to gesso. However, you have to do something with the sides and the back, and so what I did was I chose to, let me bring it in, this is a different shape, but the process is going to be the same. I chose to cover the entire piece in antique linen distress paint. You need color on there anyway, as I said, for the back and the sides, but what putting it on the front does is that it allows you to have a piece that's cut, let me grab my piece, not exactly perfectly, and it really won't make any difference. If you have a slight edge someplace where perhaps your paper didn't get cut perfectly, it's really not going to matter. The antique linen paint is so close in color to the colors on this pretty scrapbook paper that it really doesn't make any difference. So let's take a giant step back and let me bring in this pad of paper. This is a 6x6 pad. It's a Prima pad, and it's called Jody Lee Butterfly Collection. And the papers in this are really, really pretty. Very much colors that I enjoy. And the nice thing is that some of these papers have prints on them that you can utilize. If you look at this house, you'll see that this is this. And all I did was cut this. I laid this out and cut it, and then so that I could align this flower and these butterfly elements to fall on this corner of the house. Now I did come in with a marker and just add some areas mark some areas so that it kind of stood up a little bit. But all things being equal, this is this. And there's lots of different papers in here that you can use, fronts and backs. Now one of the things that you'll notice, and again I'm going to come back here, these are art tiles. Because I was working on these houses immediately after working on the art tiles, I had them strewn all over my workbench. So one of the things that I discovered is that while these are square, these elements here, and you'll see as you look through the pad that there are some other elements. Now these are rectangular, but they were too big for my windows. So what I did was I took, if you look at this paper, you'll see that there are these little rectangular pieces here. I actually use those on my windows. Now the art tile technique is pretty straightforward. There's an entire video devoted to that, so I'm not going to cover that today, but you can certainly watch that to get an idea of what I've done here. But coming back to the paper, the nice thing is that there are elements in here. You can cut these out and use them to embellish your houses if you wish, or you can use any parts of the paper, the fronts and the backs. There's lots of different options in here. So your first step is going to be, now on this house, I elected to use two different papers. I have a different one on the top than I do on the body of the house. For this one here, I decided to go ahead and use the same piece of paper. Now what I might do is darken this roof area a little bit to let it show up or show off a little bit from the body of the house, but ultimately you'll see that I'm going to put some of this lace, I'm going to run right here along the top of the house, and then we're going to do something really cool with it with type charms, but we got to get there first. So what you want to do is take your house, lay it on your piece of paper. Now these houses are perfectly symmetrical, but they're cut by a human being who is obviously not perfect. So my suggestion is, if this is, well, let's use this. If this is the side that you want on the front of your house, and this is the front of your house, turn this over and turn this over so that when you pick this up after it's cut, you have the front cutout to match the exact front of this. As I said, they should be symmetrical, but it doesn't mean that they couldn't be off a smidge. And then what you'll discover when you do this, when you write with a pencil and you trace an outline of an object like this, you're always going to have the width of the pencil mark that makes the piece grow in all directions. Every time you have a pencil mark, the piece grows. So what you have to do is once you get this marked, when you start to cut this, now I used a rotary cutter and a mat and a ruler for this, but when you start to cut this, be certain that you cut on the inside of the pencil lines, and that will help ensure that you get a piece that actually fits the front of your house. Now, having said that, I did just what I explained a moment ago, and I still had to come back and do some fussy trimming. It's just the nature of the beast. You can't help but have to do that. So once you have this done, the next step is to use some gel medium, and you don't need to see me do this, but all I'm going to do is use a brush, and I'm going to put a reasonably heavy layer of gel medium on the front of this. I'm going to put this on, get it all aligned, smooth it with my fingers so that it's nice and tight on there and there's no lumps or ripples. Now this is, you know, cardstock weight, so it's reasonably thick. It should not ripple all that much, but you want to smooth everything with your fingers and make sure you don't have any excess gel anywhere. Then once you get that done, we'll come back and we'll talk about the ways that we're going to embellish this house. I've started embellishing the house, so let me catch you up to what I've done so far. As I said in the last segment, I did want to set the roof off quite a bit from the body of the house, and I did that by taking vintage photo ink on one of the mini blending tools, just dip and dab to go around the line of the roof. And I also came and did it right along here so that there would definitely be that darker line just above the lace trimmings. And then I put the lace trimmings in place. Now in the package, you get two widths. For the size of this house, proportionally the narrower one was better, so that's what I went with. I applied a little bit of glue up along this edge, put it in place, and then once it's set up, I started to use the type charms. Now these come in a package with X number. I'm not entirely sure how many there are in there. And you can see that it's a charm with a little loop on top, and there are these prepared self-adhesive pieces that look like keys from a typewriter. You just peel them off, go ahead and put them in place in here. This just pops right off there, and then you do the same thing with this little domed resin piece. It kind of acts like a magnifying glass. And so I've spelled out the word home. Here's the last one. Now to attach these, I could have glued them in place, but one of the new releases from Winter 2015 CHA, let me turn that so you can see it, are these little screw eyes. And let me show you, I think it gives it kind of a different look because you can see that they actually dangle off the screw eyes, which I liked. So what I did, and what you'll need to do, this is some kind of an awl. It's just a pointy thing that I can poke and make a hole with. What I want to is make a pilot hole so that when I put this screw eye in there, I have a place to start it and I'm not struggling. So what I need to do is just come and eyeball about the spot that's evenly, what I did was I put the two end ones on first, and then I find that makes it a little bit easier to space the middle two. So I just need to figure out about where the middle of these two is, and it falls right in that hole. So I'm going to start my pilot hole by, this is poplar, so it's reasonably soft wood, by pushing the point of the awl in there, and now what I've got is a pilot hole. It'll make putting this a lot simpler. So you just go ahead and feed the pointy end into that pilot hole, and you begin to turn. And these are self-threading, so once it starts to catch, you'll feel the resistance grow, and it gets a little bit harder to turn this with your fingers. At that point, you can bring in a pair of pliers and just gently continue to turn this and allow the thing to drill its own hole and finish getting itself lodged in the wood. All right, that looks about right. So now what I have, this is ready to go. What I need to do is use a jump ring and attach the M. All of this has the silvery pewter color trimmings, so I've chosen that color in the screw eye because the package includes three colors, and that color in the jump rings. And these are, this is the smaller of the two jump rings that come in the package. Whoops, I'm all thumbs today. Did you ever have one of those days? That's what I'm having at the moment. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and open the jump ring, put the M charm on, and then I'm just going to go ahead and feed that through. And then grab this and twist the jump ring closed. Now that's not very well done very well, but you can see the process, and I'll go back and fix that afterward. Now are these perfectly spaced? Uh-uh. Do I care? You bet I don't. It is what it is. If I feel like they are too far off, I could always back this out and redo them, but I'm pretty satisfied with that. Now if I bring in the original one that I started with, you can see that, and you'll see this as we go along, I'm kind of omitting doors and windows this time. I'm not feeling like I have to spend a lot of time. This is recognizable as a house figure or as a house shape. I don't necessarily feel the need to go ahead and put doors and windows on there. Sometimes they don't have to be quite that realistic. But what I am going to do is mimic what I did here. This is the S, the super fine tip. This is a brown pit pen. And so what I'm going to do is mimic what I've done here, which is to go ahead and just put the stitching on it. I think it gives it a nice finished look, and you can see how darn easy this is. It's not like it's going to take a lot of time. So I'll just do that up the side, and I'll come around and outline the roof, and then I'll come back down this side. And then this house is probably done, except for maybe, well, these are the new heirloom roses. Beautiful little roses come in two sizes, in the package. You have the large one and the small one. I'll probably mimic this. And then the other thing I'm going to do, this small talk book of sayings printed with white on black and black on white has become my new favorite thing. I love the sayings in here. So there's one in here that says, listen to your heart, it will show you the way. And of course I managed to put it back on here and attach it to the one directly above it. So let me slip this out of here. I think what I'm going to do, let me turn and orient this toward me. I think what I'm going to do is place one of the heirloom roses, grab my scissors, and I'm going to separate this right at the comma after heart. And I'm just going to lay this where I think it might go. And I think I'm going to separate the last part of this phrase. Let's see. Listen to your heart, it will show you the way. I think I'll do it this way. I'll break it right here. And again, these are not perfectly in place, but this is kind of what I think I'm going to do, something along these lines. Now, what you'll notice, if I bring the original back in, is that this is not white, and these are very white. Very easy way to take care of that. All you want to do is use antique linen, again, on one of these mini ink blending tools, there's the word I was looking for. You just come in and you do this, and I don't want to do it now because I'm going to stick it someplace where it doesn't belong, but you can easily change the color of this white so that it blends a little bit more with the colorways of this house. And at that point, I'm satisfied that this house is done. And then the next thing I want to do, let's get these out of the way, bring in this. We saw this a little while ago. I've done all of the gessoing on this now. Someplace here, this is not the one I'm looking for. Someplace here is a piece of the Melage tissue wrap that is earmarked to go on here. I'm going to put some gel medium on here, go ahead and lay the tissue wrap on, and it will move a little bit so you can make sure it's good and straight. I'm going to do the same thing here that I did when I put this on, is to rub my fingers along this and make certain that there's no lumps of gel medium on there. Go ahead and let it dry, and then I'm going to come back and show you how I trim it off so the sides are all even. With the gel medium dry, I can go ahead and trim the excess tissue wrap off. You can see I've already got one side and the roof line already done, and I've already come in here and done this little edge by the eave. So what I want to do, and I'm going to turn this way, and then I'm going to turn it around so I can see it, because I'm not left-handed. I'm going to hold this loose piece with my thumb as I draw the blade down the side. That way I know I'm not going to tear it or pull it. If you try to do this before the gel medium is really dry, the paper is soft, or the tissue wrap is soft, and you're very liable to tear it. So again, I'm holding this with my finger, which I know you can't see, but I'm going to show you in 1 second along the bottom, and then I'm just going to draw the knife down the side like this, and you can see that this piece pops off without any difficulty. So I've got that side clean. So now let me turn this so you can see it. A little bit of excess gel medium on my thumb there. So all I'm going to do again is put the blade down. You want a sharp knife on your X-Acto blade. Excuse me, you want a sharp blade on your X-Acto knife. Otherwise you're liable to tear instead of cutting, and that's just a cause for tears and frustration. You don't want to do that. So once this is all set, now the front of my house is ready to go. And you can see I've actually already started to color that butterfly. I couldn't wait. I was playing while the edges were finishing drying. So I know what I'm going to do is take a butterfly from our insects collage sheet, or a moth, whatever this is, and I think I'm going to perch it something like this. And again, because I have all the art tiles left over, I'm going to turn this and orient it toward me. This is one of the ones that I made during the process of filming the art tiles video. Again, this is an insect, this is a dragonfly from our insects collage sheet. I think I'm going to lay this something like this. I think this is going to go here. Now, all I did once I cut this out was I used a little bit of paint on the back, just enough so that it's not stark white, and then if I hold the body right by the edge of the wing and press, I can gently fold the wings upward so that the butterfly becomes a little bit more three-dimensional. I think I'm going to have that perched there. This is the Industrious Stickers Frames and Trims set. It has these really narrow borders in it, so I'm going to grab this one out of here. And I think what I'm going to do, rather than just run it here from the side of the house to the side of the house, I think I'm actually going to catch it right on the edge of that eave, and I'm going to run it all the way across like this. Now I'll come back and I'll adhere this with the super thick tacky glue, just because this gets a little bit, not glossy because it's a matte finish, but this gets to be kind of non-porous once the gel medium really penetrates the tissue wrap, and so I want this to dry on, excuse me, I want it to stick on there really well, and a way to make certain that that happens is to use some additional adhesive besides what's already on the sticker. So that's done. Now again, I'm going to glue this in place, but for now this is kind of what we've got, and then we'll have something more or less like this. So what you can do, if you want, bring in some of your distress markers. I've got three colors at the moment. I have Faded Jeans, Cracked Pistachio, and this is Tumbled Glass. And I'm going to use the brush end, and you can just come in and lay some color on here and kind of rub it around with your fingers. If you want a little bit more green, you can come in with the Cracked Pistachio and just change the color a little bit that way. Whatever your decor is that you want to put these with, or whatever the color is that you feel like you want to work with today, it's very easy to do using the markers like this. You just need to smudge it a little bit with your finger. Now, if you find that the color doesn't want to move readily, then just come back with a little bit of water. Just tap your finger in a little bit of water, and you can certainly get it to move like that. Again, I just want to put a little bit of color here. Now, you can see where that color kind of stuck. So again, if I just put a little bit of water out, I can come in and dab this, and I can soften that color. Now, most of it actually came off, but once this is dry, I can come back and redo it. So nothing is carved in stone here. That's kind of the nice thing about this. If I want to add a little bit of depth of color there, smudge it around a little bit, I can do that. That's how simple it is to do this. So what else am I going to do? I have these index labels, and I took one of the remnant rubs. Honestly, I don't remember which set this came from, but you can see I took this flying insect and I went and I put it on the index label. So if I were to do this like this, and I have to be careful because this is really sticky and I don't want to commit to this yet, I could perhaps do this like this and then maybe put the butterfly here. And again, as I said, though this isn't technically a door, on this group of houses I'm kind of foregoing windows and doors for just a more overall kind of, not necessarily a house with windows kind of thing, but an overall house look. It gives you the idea because of the shape that it's a house, but I don't necessarily feel like they have to have windows and doors. So the other thing that I could do would be to come in with a pen and put some stitching around here if I want, but I think that this house is mostly done. I don't necessarily think it needs a lot more. They can be very simple if you choose to have them be that way. Now obviously I need to deal with the sides and the back, and I can do that with some distress paint. Not a big deal at all. I want to bring in the last two shapes. Now lest you think, let me wipe up this water, lest you think that these are actually the same as the original Wonky houses, I can assure you that they're not. This is the original Wonky House number 4. You can see that it has very straight sides. On these two new Wonky houses, and these are the same shape, they're just a little bit small, one is a little bit smaller than the other, what's happened is rather than the sides of the house be straight, I angled them in so that we got a little bit different shape. I think that it looks different than what we have here, and it was something that I thought was really interesting. Before I show you my finger painting technique, which is how I did house number 5 here, I want to talk about this one. And though we have seen this shape before, I haven't talked about the technique that I used to create the front of this, and I'm going to refer you back to the art tiles video. You've seen several art tiles, I've pulled them in, I've used them for windows and doors, and here are some other examples. And you can see that the process gives you basically the exact same results. You're going to work on a larger surface, but the steps and the technique are identical. So if you're interested in something like this, I would refer you to our art tiles video, and I'll put a link to that video in the description of this one so that you can find it. And it just takes a few moments longer because you're working on a larger surface, but this process is actually really easy. So let's come back now to our Wonky House number 5 and the finger painting technique. Now, this is the larger of the two. So this is Wonky House number 7 and this is number 5. You can see that these are the houses with the sides that come in and get narrower toward the top of the house, and then you obviously have this tall peak. So the process is really straightforward, and it always begins with gesso. Remember back in the beginning I said everything was going to begin with gesso and then I contradicted myself? Well, this one really does begin with gesso. So I'm going to put out a little bit of lime green. Now, I'm not going to do all the sides of the house. I want to show you the basics of how I do this, and then you can obviously apply that technique to the sides and the back of the house. So I have lime green, turquoise, and Knight Dina Wakely's paint. And all I'm going to do, now that this is dry, again, gesso everywhere here, I'm going to take, I always start with the lightest color, and for me that typically is lime green here, and I'm just going to lightly apply some color here and there. Now, one of the things that you'll notice is that there's a fair amount of white space here. This is not solid coverage. I like that look. You can choose to go more solid if you want, but you don't have to. So again, this looks pretty good. I just want to spread this around with my fingers, maybe a little bit more down here. Now I'll pick up some of the turquoise. Now, I'm not waiting as long as I ordinarily should, so what's going to happen is in some places we're going to see some blending of color. These colors are all adjacent on the color wheel, so that means I'm not going to get mud. There's no problem there. If I were not rushing to try to get through this for you and, you know, trying to make this as brief as possible, then I would actually let these layers dry in between. Now, Knight is a really dark color, so I want to be very judicious in how much of it I use. Oops, well, got to get a little blending there because I mixed them on my finger. But you can see that this is about as much coverage as I want. So now what I'm going to do is just pick up a little bit of Knight, and I'm going to knock most of the color off my finger. And I just want to come in and very lightly apply some here and there. One of the things that I find myself having to be cautious of is that I don't get stripey when I do this. I have a tendency to work from top to bottom, and so to avoid that, I find myself wanting to do what you just saw me do, which is to kind of go back and forth. The other thing that you can do is you can kind of mix these, which will tone down the Knight a little bit. Certainly, again, we're talking about colors that are adjacent to one another on the color wheel, so there's no problem with that at all. All right, so what I need to do is I need to come in with the heated craft tool, and I want to just go ahead and make certain that all of this is dry because I'm going to get in a mess if it's not. So let me dry this and then I'll come back and I'm going to show you the next step. We're going to go ahead and we're going to put these white circles on here. We're going to outline them. We're going to do some spattering, but this is really quick and easy. This process is very fast but very effective. So let me dry this off and then we'll get started on the next steps. Paint's dry, and in fact I took the opportunity and I went ahead and did all the sides so that it's just ready to go. So the next step is going to be to come in with our nonsense Latin text, and this is the tiny version, and I just want to stamp this randomly. I want to create some layers and just a little bit of depth. You'll notice that I'm not doing anything fancy. I'm not being super careful about how I ink the stamp. I'm just going ahead and applying the text. Now, I will do that on all the sides as well. I can go ahead and put some here, but I'm not going to take the time to do that now. The process obviously is the same. You repeat it over all the sides. So there's the text, and it's created some layers for us. So the next step is we want to do these white dots. And for that, I'm going to bring in, this is our circle dot grid. I can't think of what the stencil is called. Isn't that awful? But this is one of ours, and it has these two sizes of dots on it. So I'm going to break out the gesso again. Dotted grid, that's what the stencil is called. Now, I don't want to center these on here. I kind of want them off. I want some of them falling off the side. So I think what I'm going to do is take advantage of how this is on here. I'm going to put one right up here. So I'm going to dip my finger, and that's it. You can see some of the text through there. I like that. Through the gesso, and I really like that, so that's fine. Now I think what I'm going to do is just, again, pick up a little bit more of the gesso. Now you can do this so that you get a really thick opaque layer. You can do it a little bit lighter. You'll notice that this is not perfect. I'm all about that. It's so much easier to achieve imperfection. So I'm going to go ahead and put that on there. And then maybe I will come in, and so I don't run the stencil into one that's already on there, I'll come in and I'll do this here halfway off the side, and then maybe put a smidge right here. This is how simple this is. It's very, very straightforward. Now obviously you have to give this time to dry, because you can't write around here, write around these shapes with any kind of a pen. It's going to make the tip very unhappy. So again, let me dry this and then I'll come back and I'll show you the next steps. Everything is dry now, and in between, while I was working on these dots, I also took the opportunity to do the spattering so I wouldn't have to go away again and let that dry. You can see the kind of turquoise colored dots on here. That's just spattering. I used Waterfall Green, De La Rowney F&W Pearlescent Ink, put some out on my work table, took a fan brush that had some water in it, swished it around like this to kind of mix it up and make that a little bit more liquidy, and then it's just a question of tapping like this. That is what gives you all of those spatters. So with all of that dry, now I can turn my attention to what I want to do to these dots. I'm going to take a black Sharpie. This is the water-based paint marker in the extra fine tip, and all I'm going to do is just come in, and very loosely I want to make concentric circles around my white circle. You'll notice that, as always, I'm not looking for perfection. I'm very happy to have something that's totally imperfect. Again, far easier to achieve that way. That's all you have to do there. Now you'll notice that there are some ideology elements on here, and there's also some stitching. One thing, let me show you the stitching before we jump into the ideology. I just want to make sure that black marker is dry. So what I've done is use, this is a black super fine tip in the Pitt pen, and all I did I have one that doesn't want to write. All I did was come along and use this pen, and I did the stitching up the side. There we go. Now it's writing better. I can come back and fix these after the fact. Anyway, I just came in and ran the stitching up the side, and I let it run around the various circles as they ran off the side. I also came in and I did it around all the freestanding ones like this. Again, all of these things add layers of texture and pattern and make things really interesting to look at. That's all there is to that. You see, I took some Chit Chat stickers. Again, I just kind of drew around them to frame the words. Now, the only other piece that's left to how I embellish this, these are number brads, and then someplace here, what did I do with it, is that little teeny star fastener. So these were also new in winter 2015 CHA. You can see that they're all shaped like a star. You get however many of these you do. You have the copper color, the brass color, and then the typical pewter color like you see here. So the way to make these work, because obviously these are intended to put through a piece of paper and then you spread the brad legs on the back to hold it in place, the way that you have to make these work is to remove the legs on the brad. So for that, just come in and grab your wire cutters and go ahead and nip that leg off. Do the same thing on the other side, and then I'll show you. You'll have to kind of push this. You want to get that clipped in as tight as possible. And then what you do is just kind of hold this with your finger and then come in with the scissors and either pop that off because the metal will snap, or just go ahead and push it in so that whatever's left on that leg ends up lying flat against the back, and now you have a little flat piece. Some of the Aileen's, the super thick tacky glue, which I have a jar here someplace, again on the back, will hold that securely in place as you see here. And for the number brads, it's the same thing. Just go ahead and pull the legs of the brads up, the legs of the brad up. Go ahead and nip them off. And then just use the point of your wire cutters to push them back down inside. And then you can go ahead and place them on your white dots. Now I chose to not let mine hang over the side, so I only did them on places on dots where there was enough room to do that. But that's it. So we have four new Wonky Wood Houses. We have numbers 4. Let me think about this. Nope. We have 5, 6, and 7. This is 5. This is 7. And you've seen the other two. I'll have pictures of all of these finished houses up on the website on the page where the video is posted. And I hope you try them too. They really are a lot of fun.